So a couple of notes about these tests. Anytime we're making changes to our terminals using a screwdriver and making adjustments to the wires, we want to make sure our controller's off. That helps prevent any slip of the screwdriver from shorting out any contacts and damaging the controller. For a majority of these tests, you're going to need a multimeter. In this case, we have a clamp-on style where we can test current and we can test voltage with the probes. If you have another style with just the probes, that's just as fine. We can do a majority of the tests as well. On most multimeters, there's either dials or push buttons where you can select the mode. In this case, we set it to voltage, resistance measurement, or current measurements. For test number one, we want to make sure the controller is getting power. And for that test, we want to set it to voltage. But on this meter, it's the same setting for voltage, whether it's AC or DC, except we need to push the button to switch it to DC mode. Now we can test DC voltages. If you have it in AC, you're going to get strange readings and it's not going to work correctly. Other multimeters have a dial where you can select either voltage DC or voltage AC. So we set it to voltage DC, and now we want to test the input to the controller to make sure the controller is getting power. We have the switch off, and we're going to take our probes and we're going to connect the red one to P plus and the black one to P minus and check our voltage reading. In here you can see we're getting about 42.6 volts. And so that's a good reading. Out of each of these panels, we want to see about 22 volts. And in this case, we have two in series, so we want to see around 44. And anywhere from 40 to 44 is a good reading. If you have our RPS 400 or RPS 800, you'd be looking for around 80 to 88 volts VOC, which is when the pump is not operating and the controller's off. If you don't see any voltage, it means you might have your panels wired up incorrectly, or there's an issue with one of your connectors and it's not seated properly. You want to go connector by connector and check both the wires and the clips to make sure they're fully seated and that you don't have any opens on your series connections. So let's say we've tested from P plus to P minus and we're getting 0 volts or something less than 44. Say if you're getting a strange reading like 20 volts and you have multiple panels in series. That means you could have a high resistance open somewhere in your series connections. So in this case, we want to test each panel individually to check if the panel is putting out the power. So we want to undo our series connections and get the plus and the minus from a single solar panel. With our multimeter in voltage DC mode, we want to put the probes up into each connector and to check if we have voltage present. In this case, we can see out of one panel, we're getting 21.06 volts. That's a good reading. You want to see something in between 20 to 22 volts. We'll move on to our next panel, check that panel and see if it is also putting out power. If both your panels are putting out power, it could mean you have a loose connection somewhere inside your MC4s, likely your extension wire going from your panels up to your controller. You want to work your way then, with everything connected, up the wires, checking for voltage at each connection point. And very likely along the way, you'll find somewhere where you're not seeing the voltage present, and that'll be your point where you need to go in, remove the backside of the MC4 connectors, and check for any loose wire. So for test number three, we want to check the continuity of our pump wires down our drop wire, through our splice, and into the windings of the pump. It's very common we see this when we get strange things like the error light coming on, or the low power light coming on, or where you feel like there's just some like humming from the pump, but it's not actually turning or pumping any water. That could mean a bad splice from your drop wire to your pump. To do this test, we want to first remove our pump wires from the controller. And then we want to test the continuity between each of the three phases of the pump. To do this, we will set our multimeter to ohms. This is the resistance measurement. Now this one's auto ranging, so it's able to go from low resistances up to high resistances. It's very likely on your multimeter, you may have different selections for resistance. And in this case, you want to choose something low, something like the 10 ohm or 20 ohm range. So we'll take the multimeter and measure between each of the three pump wires. We'll start with 1 to 2. And we're getting 1.2 ohms. So that's a good reading. You're going to get somewhere around 1.1 up to around 2 or 3 ohms, depending on the length of your drop wire. Now we'll test from 1 to 3. And again, we're getting something like 1.3, 1.2 again. Next, we'll go from 2 to 3. And we're getting somewhere around 0.8. So those are all in the right range. We want to see them fairly close together. We don't want two of them at 1.3 and then the other one up at something like 4. They should be all within 1 ohm of each other. Now we've verified that we have continuity, we have a good connection from our drop wire down through our pump and back up to the controller. So if you're not getting the volume of water you want, you've checked the angle of your solar panels, you've made sure you're getting the proper power to your controller and to your pump, or if you're just not getting any water at all and your pump light's turning on and it might be going to low power, it might be going to error, you've checked that your dial is completely up on speed up to 10, it may mean you need to replace your pumping mechanism. It might have been damaged from running multiple years, maybe you have a lot of silt or sand in your water, or maybe it ran outside of the water and it got damaged before you put it down. In that case, unfortunately, you're gonna have to pull up the pump, you're gonna have to replace the pumping mechanism. All of our kits come with one free pumping mechanism, and then we have a lifetime warranty. So if you ever use that pumping mechanism, just shoot us an email and we'll send out a replacement right away so you always have an extra on hand. So you pull that up, replace the pumping mechanism. There's a video in the comments below so you can see how to do that. It takes about 5 or 10 minutes. Put it back together, go back down your well, and it should be pumping as good as new. So for test number 5, we want to make sure we're getting power down to our pump. And in this case, we'll turn our multimeter to voltage, but we want it voltage AC. So in this case, we don't have to change anything. And if you have a dial that has voltage AC and voltage DC, just turn it to voltage AC. Then we want to take our multimeter probes and test while the pump is on and it says it's pumping. We want to test between 1 and 2 to get a voltage reading. In this case, we're getting 29 volts. That's a pretty good reading. We then want to test from 1 to 3. And again, we're getting 29 volts. That's a good reading. And we want to test from 2 to 3. And again, we're getting 29 volts. All about the same. That's a good reading. And that means our system's fine, and in this case, our pump is pumping. Now, just a warning, this is not a true AC signal coming from the controller to the pump. It's a square wave simulated sinusoidal wave. So the multimeters, depending on your exact version, will read it okay. You're not gonna get a true reading of the voltage going down to the pump, but it's a good indicator that the pump is getting power and that all three phases are getting the same approximate AC value for voltage. For test number 6, might be when you have different lights on, like the tank full light, and it might appear to be stuck on, or the well low light, it also might appear to be stuck on. You try different troubleshooting, you just can't get the system to operate. In this case, we want to turn off the controller. Then we want to make sure our pump is submerged. You want to make sure it's down in the well, in water, or if you have a bucket, you can place the pump in the bucket. Then we want to remove any of our sensors. In this case, from COM2 to tank high, the tank high sensor, it's not hooked up, but we're going to remove the well low sensor. And in its place, we want to put a little jumper instead. This will override the low well sensor and force the controller to turn on. Then we'll turn the pump on, and see if the pump operates. One word of warning is you are overriding the low well sensor. So if your pump really isn't water, you're going to possibly burn up your pumping mechanism, and then you're gonna have to pull it and replace it. So in this case, the water started flowing. That means everything with the controller, the solar panels, the pump is good. Then we need to troubleshoot our low well sensor or our tank full sensor to see what's going on with it. Maybe there's an open in the wires, maybe there's a short. We need to go check further and see if we can find any damage or if any of the sensors are in or out of water when we think they shouldn't be. For test number 7, we can see our low well light is off. That's because we have the hard jumper across COM 1 to well high, but our tank full light seems to be stuck on. Now I went up to the tank and I checked, and the sensor's out of the water, so the pump should be operating and the tank full light should be off. So in this case, we want to turn the system off, and we want to remove the sensor wires from the controller. And we'll turn the controller back on. This will deactivate the tank full sensing of the controller, and as you can see, the light turned off and the pump is starting to pump again. If your tank full light stays on and you don't have anything connected to COM 2 or tank high, it could indicate a problem with your controller, and you should give us a call for further troubleshooting. So if things just aren't working quite right with your system, say maybe the low well light, it seems to be stuck on, it's always good to do a reset. There's two different types of resets, a soft reset and a hard reset. For a soft reset, we'll take our 3-position switch and move it to the center position. That'll cut power to the electronics. We'll let it sit a couple of seconds, make sure everything discharges, and we'll turn it back on. You can see the lights all flash, and then it goes through its startup sequence of power, pump, maximum power point tracking. If that doesn't fix your problems, you want to try what's called a hard reset. So in that case, we want to cut power completely to all of the electronics. We want to turn the switch to the center position, shut it off. We want to shade our solar array to make sure there's not high voltage at the connectors. And then we want to disconnect the power connection going into the controller. That ensures all power is cut to the controller. Again, we give it a couple of seconds, make sure everything discharges. You plug it back in, turn the switch forward to the solar position, and then test and see if we're getting power to the controller, which we are, and then the pump light should turn on and the system starts to operate normally. Before you start into the other troubleshooting, it's always good to just do a soft or a hard reset in order to make sure it's not something in the software of the controller. So following the steps in this video and our detailed troubleshooting flowchart, you're going to be able to solve majority of the issues you encounter when you're first setting up your system or you're getting it back up and running after winter. If you try these steps and you still can't get it, feel free to give us a call. We're always happy to help. We have engineers standing by, ready to help you with further troubleshooting and making sure you get your system up and running. This is Mike with RPS Solar Pumps. If you're interested in a solar pump, visit us at rpssolarpumps.com. And if you encounter any issues, like I said, give us a call or text us, and we're happy to help.